Sachette Audio presents The Dead of Winter, The Demons, Witches and Ghosts of Christmas. Written by Sarah Clegg. Read by Hannah Curtis. Introduction and Epilogue. Read by Sarah Clegg.
For Max, for every joyous Christmas together so far, and every one to come, and also for this one when you came with me to wassails and Krampus runs and Stonehenge solstices, I think it would be impossible to love someone more than I love you. A sad tale's best for winter. I have one of sprites and goblins. William Shakespeare, The Winter's Tale. Introduction, The Year Walk. 24th December. Before dawn on Christmas Eve, I slip out of the house and into a howling, windswept night, the bells of the Christmas wreath jingling wildly as I pull the front door closed behind me. I haven't spoken to anyone since midnight. I haven't looked into any fires. I haven't eaten anything. I brought a torch with me, hoping that it doesn't count as a fire on some technicality, but I needn't have worried. Behind the scudding clouds, there's a bright moon, nearly full, flooding the countryside with a cold white glow. Even in complete darkness, though, I feel like I know my way. I'm at my parents' house for Christmas, and these are paths I've walked since I was a child. Up to the top of the road, turn left. Past the shattered stump of the medieval wayside cross, over the drainage ditch, turn right onto the old farm track. The route is so familiar, and yet this morning it feels off-kilter, shifting in the ever-changing moonlit shadows and the fierce wind that's wrenching the trees into twisted shapes. I'm walking faster than I need to, tripping in the two large boots I've borrowed from my mother, trying not to look too hard or linger too long. I know I mustn't let my unease turn into fear. At best, fear might undo the magic I'm trying to invoke. At worst, it could summon something dangerous. Once I've hopped the fence into the meadows, I stop. I'm supposed to be getting far enough away from the houses that I can't hear a cock crow, and while no one keeps chickens in the village anymore, I've read online that the sound carries about a mile. This is far enough. I turn, bearing right across the field into a little patch of woodland, until I can see the village church ahead of me, the whitewashed tower a beacon in the moonlight, looming over the trees. My path puts me out at the edge of the graveyard, a dark, glittering Christmas tree just across the road. I perch on the low stone wall that rings the sprawling patch of gravestones and settle down to watch for the ghosts of next year's dead. It was the Christmas witches who brought me here. While researching child-murdering demons with iron body parts, I ran into Perkta, a monstrous witch with an iron nose who travels house to house every Christmas leading a cavalcade of the dead. If she finds a child who hasn't done their chores, she slits open their belly, pulls out their guts, stuffs them with straw and then sews up the wound with a plowshare as a needle and a chain as thread. She is utterly, joyously monstrous. And when I first stumbled across her, that connection with Christmas, a time we're more likely to associate with presents, merriment and feasting than murder and dark magic, felt jarring in the extreme. But if you look a little closer, you'll find that Christmas teems with monsters. There's Krampus, a hideous, towering demon with enormous horns who beats children with a switch or steals them away, and who rampages through Germany and Austria every 5th of December. In Iceland, there's Grýla, an ogress who comes down from the mountains at Christmas and is inclined to eat her victims, popping them into a giant stew while her murderous cat, the Yule Cat, prowls at her side. In France, there's Père Fouettard, Father Whipper, a butcher who had kidnapped, murdered, and tried to pickle three young boys before he was stopped by St. Nicholas. As punishment, according to the legend, he was forced to accompany St. Nicholas for the rest of eternity, a looming figure lurking behind the saint, whipping children who don't deserve St. Nicholas's presence. The supernatural dangers of Christmas aren't just limited to misbehaving children either. There are accounts that speak of how witches were thought to be more active in midwinter, of how werewolves were more likely to turn during the Christmas period. It's a time too when the dead return, sometimes led by the Christmas witches in a rampaging horde, and sometimes as solemn, sad hauntings. It's a haunting I'm trying to conjure now, as I sit in the dark graveyard, the wind howling around me. I'm on a year walk, or arsang, a tradition that has been attested for centuries in Swedish folklore, which tells how a walk taken before dawn on Christmas Eve without eating or drinking, without talking to anyone, without looking into a fire, will show the future. More specifically, it should show me shadowy enactments of the burials of anyone who will die in the village this coming year. It might even show me mine. There's an oft-repeated story of a man who stumbled across his own funeral procession on just such a walk as this. Waiting in the icy darkness, the bare trees swaying violently in the wind, the church dead and empty, it feels almost believable. It's not just the night and my own jumpiness that make the morning feel strange and ominous. It's the very fact that it's Christmas, a time we've set apart, turning it into a strange, sparkling otherworld of gift-bearing visitors flying through the sky, the fairy lights glinting among trees we've dragged inside from some dark, distant forest. If magic were ever real, it would be real now. On this Christmas Eve morning, I am on the cusp of the climax, the final day before the more intense festivities truly begin, festivities that will culminate in the end of the old year and the beginning of the new. And new beginnings always beget omens. On top of that, the winter solstice and the longest night were just 2 days before. I am buried almost as deeply as I can be in darkness. No matter how much jollity we associate with the season, you can't deny that it's the perfect time for some arcane prophesying as well. And if there's any truth to the stories of the year walk, I need to stay alert. The future doesn't always want to be seen, and there are warnings of dangers that lurk on journeys such as these, preserved in multiple accounts held in the Swedish folklore archive. In one version, the yearwalker loses an eye to the ghosts. In others, they lose their sanity. Sometimes they simply disappear into the night, never to return. The graves in the cemetery might open, releasing those who died unhappy deaths. Or a huge sow with glowing eyes covering its entire body might emerge to block the walker's path. Showing fear is one of the ways to summon these monsters, or stop the magic altogether. Laughter will also break the spell, and though someone might be unlikely to burst into giggles at the sight of an unhappy revenant or a horrifying pig, there is a yearwalk story in which two tiny farting rats appear in the path of the walker, causing him to laugh and forgo his chance of seeing the future. No farting rats, walking corpses or multi-eyed sows appear in front of me this morning, but no ghostly funeral processions cross into the graveyard either. I'm a long way into my vigil before it occurs to me that there are only a handful of burial plots left in the churchyard. Most people who die in the village will need to be buried in modern cemeteries and crematoriums, so even supposing that the year walk magic is working just fine, the odds of encountering a ghostly burial procession were always low. Perhaps I'll have more luck with another method. According to some versions of the folklore, if the walker circles the church 3 times and looks through the keyhole of the door, they'll see a premonition of a service a year from now. Anyone missing from their pew will be dead before the year is out. I slip down from my perch on the wall and walk round the church, stumbling on the uneven ground, counting the circuits, and then I head to the little stone porch. There's a modern mesh door barring the entrance, which I expect to be locked. It normally is when the church is closed. But to my surprise, when I pull the handle, it swings open. I duck inside, into a deeper darkness that's hidden even from the moonlight, a tinsel star hung from the ceiling swinging in the wind above my head. I give my eyes a moment to adjust to the gloom and look for a keyhole in the ancient oak door in front of me. There isn't one. After a moment's hesitation, I reach for the latch. If the mesh door was unlocked, the main door might be too. But as I push the latch down, all I can think about is another thread of yearwalk folklore, which says that every Christmas Eve, before dawn, the dead themselves hold their own church services, and they don't like it when the living try to attend, or they'll insist that the living stay. If the yearwalk magic can truly be broken by fear, this is the moment it would snap. Loath as I am to admit it, standing in that dark doorway, pushing down on the latch, feeling it give beneath my finger and start to lift, I'm afraid of what I might find waiting for me inside the church. But the door is locked. After the initial give, the latch refuses to yield any further. I walk back outside, a little relieved, to see that the darkness is thinning, a scorched white line appearing on the horizon. I turn to head back, but take the route directly through the village rather than over the fields, keeping an eye out for any ghostly flames that should be burning where there'll be fires in the coming year. The last serious fire here was decades ago, long before I was born, so perhaps it's not surprising that I don't see any swirling, shadowy smoke hanging over anyone's homes. Yearwalks, it turns out, may not be as useful for predicting the dramas of modern village life as they once were. As I reach the high street, a dog walker waves at me and shouts a Christmas greeting. I feel obliged to yell one back, even if speaking to someone firmly cuts off my chance of witnessing future ghosts. There's no need for me to linger now, and besides, I'm pretty sure there are mince pies for breakfast at home. Days of Christmas cheer await, which in ordinary circumstances should shake off any idea of church services of the dead or shadowy, ominous funeral processions. But by the time I set out on my year walk, I'd already met a whole host of Christmas demons. Because the more I learned of the darkness of Christmas, the more I wanted to experience it myself, to immerse myself in these terrifying traditions that seem, at first glance, to contradict the bright magic we've built around the season. This book begins on the morning of Christmas Eve and will end on the evening of Christmas Day, but in between it will roam through the whole winter season. From murderous plains.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.